First, capitalism has a tendency everywhere to polarize income and wealth. It's a kind of driven system in which the competition, as you all know, of enterprises one with the other is pretty cutthroat. And most of the time, the company that wins the competition literally eats the one that has been defeated, buys its equipment, hires away its workers, and so we get the ever larger winners. That's why most big industries have two or three left. They've consumed all the others. The unemployment rate, which today is about 8.5% officially, number of adults looking for work as a percentage of our labor force, if you look at the comparable number in the depths of the Depression, it was three times that, 25%. So really very bad. And interestingly, in the 1930s, the American people pushed back. They were not passive, they were active. Let me tell you what they did, because it's a part of our history that Americans tend not to learn too well in school, for reasons I will leave to your speculation. We had the biggest labor movement organization that the country ever had. Something called the Congress of Industrial Organizations organized millions of workers in the 1930s, in the depths of the Depression. Workers who had never been in a union before. We've never seen that in the United States. We had never seen it before, and we've never seen it since. In the midst of that misery of the Depression, of that poverty, American workers decided that a labor union could maybe save them. And they were ready to join. And joining was often tough, working against government, working against the corporation, working against the police. Alongside the unions, the CIO that did the organizing, were two other institutions that were important then, and that may surprise you. Socialist parties here in the United States and the Communist Party of the United States were powerful. They had a lot of people, and they worked together with the CIO. And together they went to the government at that time and they said two things. We represent the mass of working people and we don't want to suffer the way we're suffering in this breakdown of capitalism. You got to do something. And they addressed themselves to a kind of middle-of-the-road Democratic politician who had just gotten elected president on a program of a balanced budget, Franklin Roosevelt. And they said to him, you've got to do something for the people. And the socialists and communists said, you've got to do something for the people, but they added a little barb, because we think that there's a better system, an alternative system to capitalism. And if you keep performing as badly as you're doing in the depths of the Depression, we're going to try to establish that alternative. And they pointed across the ocean to the Soviet Union, said, see, like them. That scared folks. And Mr. Roosevelt was a good politician, smart. He listened. And he responded because he knew politically that these three forces, CIO, socialists, and communists, had enormous support in the United States. They were very powerful. And that they could mount a serious problem for this country. So Roosevelt went to his friends. You know, he came from a very well-established, very wealthy family. And he went to his wealthy friends, many of whom were businessmen. And he said, look, I think I got to do something here, because if I don't, we're going to have a lot of trouble. And dear gentlemen, you who are very wealthy and you who run the big corporations, not only do I think we need to do this, but you're going to have to pay for it. The government has no money. We're in the depths of depression. Nobody's paying any taxes. Nobody has jobs. So you're going to have to pay, the rich and the corporations. And here's what you're going to pay for. I'm going to take care of the people. I'm going to help poor people, unemployed people, an American population that's in trouble. I'm going to help them big time, and you're going to pay for it. And you know why? Because if you don't, coming down the road are those socialists and communists, and they're going to cut you a lot less attractive deal. And you know something interesting happened? The business community and the rich were split. Half of them did not buy that argument. They were not convinced by Mr. Roosevelt. But half of them were. And Roosevelt was a good politician. With half of the businesses in his pocket, he knew he could count on the CIO, the socialists, and the communists to kind of work something out. And here was the deal. I'm going to get the money from the corporations and the rich. I'm going to help you on a scale you've never seen before. And in return, you're going to stop talking about getting rid of capitalism. You're going to mute that part of your message. You're going to celebrate me as the guy who gives the mass of people something they never got before. So what did Roosevelt do? Three interesting things that I'll mention. One, he created the Social Security system. We never had that before. In the midst of a depression worse than today, when there's no money in the hands of the government, none is coming in, it's really hard, we can't do anything, the president goes on the radio and announces that every American over 65 years of age who's had a lifetime of work is now going to get money from the government for the rest of his or her life. Thank you very much. What? Where would all the money come from? But you know, I've already told you, from taxing the corporations and the rich. And no sooner did he do that than he announced another new program, unemployment compensation. We never had that before in the United States. In the midst of a depression, when tens of millions of people are out of work, the president announces, I want to tell you all that everybody who's out of work is now going to get a government check every week for a year or two to make this easier. And who's going to pay for that? The corporations and the rich. But now comes the third program. President Roosevelt says, if the private enterprise system of the United States cannot provide work to tens of millions of American citizens who want to work, well, then I'll do it. And between 1934 and 1941, Roosevelt created and filled 12.5 million jobs. Well, you're hired by the federal government. And who paid for all of that? The corporations and the rich. Wow. I'm not describing the Soviet Union or some fantasy or some impossible dream. I'm just describing American history. And not so long ago either. Wow. Just to drive it home. What did Roosevelt, how did he actually do this? Well, he was very courageous and clever. In the midst of World War II, to make this point really strong, he proposed a novel income tax. Here's how it would work. Above a certain level, and the level in those years was $25,000 a year, the income tax rate that would have to be paid is, president's proposal, 100%. That's right. $25,000 a year would become a maximum income. You know how we have a minimum wage? This would be the maximum income, the other end. The Republicans, predictably, went crazy. And they fought and they yelled and they reached a compromise. And the compromise was that above the top, that the highest rate, the richest Americans, would henceforth have to pay 94%. The law signed by the president. If you were rich in the 1940s, every dollar over the top limit, the highest bracket that you earned, you got to keep 6 cents. And the other 94 cents went to the president and to the government.